Let's start this important lecture on professional indemnity insurance for architects. So this is a very important topic for every architect to know in India, because it's one of the three professional liabilities of an architect in India. So we'll start with a few questions. So if you design a building as an architect and the building collapses during a landslide like in Chamoli, that is like a big landslide that happened in India, are you liable to pay damages? Think about the answers to these questions. If you buy a house from a builder and the roof collapses, who is responsible, the builder or the architect? If there is waterlogging on the terrace of the roof due to no slope provided and the slab leaks, who is at fault, the architect or the contractor? If someone suffers due to sick building syndrome in this building where there was a leakage and the leakage caused, you know, algae to form or, you know, some kind of fungi to form on the wall, and he suffers due to sick building syndrome, can he demand damages from the architect? What is insurance? It's the first important question, because professional indemnity insurance has an important word called insurance. So what is insurance? Insurance is an arrangement by which a company or the state undertakes to provide a guarantee of compensation for specified loss, damage, illness, or death in return for payment of a specified premium. Now, important word over here is guarantee. We'll understand why we are focusing on guarantee and why insurance is directly linked to guarantee. Now, in 2002, under the dynamic leadership of Mr. Architect P.R. Mehta, Council of Architecture in India passed Resolution 302 and 303, which was titled Architects' Professional Liability, which said that professional negligence, which defined professional negligence, and it said that professional negligence of an architect means failure to take reasonable degree of care in the course of his engagement for rendering professional services. And this negligence leads to deficiency of service, which is defined as any fault, imperfection, shortcoming, or inadequacy in the quality, nature, and manner of the performance which is required to be maintained by or under any law for the time being in force or has been undertaken to be performed by a person in pursuance of a contract or otherwise in relation to any service. Now, very important, even though everything is written in the contract, but there are some things which are understood and not written in the contract, the architect is even responsible for them. Like, for example, it is the architect's job to make calculations. It's the architect's job to make a drawing. Now, these things will not write in the contract, but these are deemed to be the work that architect does as part of his professional duties. This means that there are some inherent and assumed responsibilities, as I just said, which may not be explicit in the contract. What are the exceptions? You know, what is not the liability of an architect? This is according to that professional liability document made by the Council of Architecture. It's a use of building for the purposes other than for which it is designed. Any changes, modifications to the building carried out by the owners without the consent or approval of the architect who designed and supervised the construction of the building. Any changes, alterations, modifications carried out by consulting another architect without the knowledge and consent of erstwhile architect or without obtaining NOC from him. Illegal, unauthorized changes, alterations, renovations, modifications carried out by the owner occupants. Any compromise with the safety norms by the owner's occupants. Distress due to leakage from terrace toilets, water logging within the vicinity of the building that would affect the strength, stability of the structure or general well-being. Lack of periodical maintenance or inadequate maintenance by the owner's occupants. Damages caused due to any reasons arising out of specialized consultants. You know, you hire somebody else who do specified work for us, like a structural consultant, etc. Deficient services with regard to design and supervision of the work entrusted to them who are appointed engaged in consultation with the client, and damages caused to the building for reasons beyond the control of an architect. Now, it's very difficult to define this, but this is where the decision and the interpretation happens. So a professional liabilities of an architect, are three. So one is that he has to have indemnity insurance, which is the topic of today's discussion. Which is the architect is required to indemnify the client against losses and damages incurred by the client through the acts of the architect and shall take out and maintain a professional indemnity insurance policy as may be mutually agreed between the architect and the client. Second, he is supposed to maintain record for a minimum period of 4 years after the completion certificate is issued. And the duration for which the architect is liable is 3 years after the building has been handed over to the owner. what happens if there is negligence? So COA will try and prove whether there was professional negligence or not. In case negligence was found, COA can re-register the architect under disciplinary action and by the but the law. So you so an architect makes a mistake. There's a negligence. So somebody saying that there's negligence done by the architect. The first person, the architect and the person and the client can go to is the Council of Architecture, which is going to first prove ki was there negligence or not. Once the Council of Architect says there was no negligence by the architect, he cannot be tried under any further laws. But once the Council of Architecture says there was negligence by the client, A, the Council of Architecture will take disciplinary action by deregistering him. Then that certification will hold in other laws, in other courts, where there'll be Law of Torts, Consumer Protection Act, and the Indian Penal Code. Criminal cases, civil suits can be filed on the architect. And what is indemnity? So we just talked about negligence and what is service and what is deficiency of service and what happens if there is a negligence. So now we need to talk about what is indemnity. Now we spoke when you were talking the definition of insurance, there's a word called guarantee. But in case of PI insurance or professional indemnity insurance, you know, you could simply call it professional insurance. Why did they use the word indemnity? Because indemnity in itself has a separate meaning. So what is indemnity? It's a security or protection against a law or other financial burden. But how is it different from the word insurance? Or rather, why do we need another term where only the word insurance will suffice? The difference lies in the word guarantee, because indemnity is different from a guarantee. Guarantee is an obligation of one party will, you know, assure the other party that the guarantor will perform the promise if the third party defaults. In indemnity, the promise is taken for granted. It is invoked only if there is a loss. So, and the loss has to be proven and it is independent of the event. For example, a person has bought an insurance, which is a guarantee. What will happen is once the person dies, regardless of how he died, regardless of what happened, the other person who has, you know, taken the insurance will get the money. In case of professional indemnity, the loss has to be proven. And it is only the matter of, you know, loss proven and the damages in terms of monetary damages have to be claimed. And those have to be proven. So it is a process where interpretation matters. So before I talk about who the professional is, I want to talk about the, you know, I'll give you an example from law. There's a thing called murder and there's another thing called culpable homicide. Now, both in both the cases, so murder is when you, you know, have killed somebody, and culpable homicide is when you, somebody got killed by you. They're two different things. The thing here is that here the difference in both the cases, the person is dead. But the difference lies in the interpretation of the law. In the first case, murder, there is a willful attempt by the person. He has done something willfully in his knowledge that he is killing the person. There's a plan. Then that is murder. But in the other case, it is like culpable homicide. The person was doing his own work and he was sitting on his table. Somebody just came and attacked him, and he was just to protect him. He picked up something and he hit him back. The other person died. This is culpable homicide, because you cannot prove that this person sitting here had any plan or intention to kill that other person. This is a very small example. So here also we have to see whether there was negligence or not. Then after negligence has been proven, you have to prove the loss, how much the loss would be. Then the loss will be evaluated. This is the monetary compensation for that loss. So it's a long process which has to be followed. And that's why it's different from a guarantee which an insurance will otherwise offer. So who's professional in this case? Engineers, architects, doctors, lawyers, chartered accountant, medical practitioners, and, you know, other people who provide services in the medical establishments. And in architecture sector, in the building sector, it's architects, engineers, landscape architects, construction managers, interior designers, and anybody who are doing allied services of architecture and building construction. On the other hand, if you design a building, another question, if you design a building and it collapses during an earthquake, are you liable to pay damages? Now, question. So the same locality, let's say 3 out of 10 buildings collapsed while the others remained intact during the same earthquake. So what will happen? Here, it is to say that it doesn't matter if other buildings collapsed or not. It doesn't matter that, you know, it was a general earthquake or it was a serious earthquake. The point here is that did the architect, within his means of knowledge and within what the law prescribed, take the minimum structural requirements that were supposed to be taken, or instruct the structural engineer to do the minimum structural requirements that are required for earthquake resistant architecture if it is prescribed by the bylaw. If the bylaw says ki you have to do earthquake resistant architecture, then architect is liable to do it because he has given approval for that building. So here the matter will be, regardless of the building fell or not fell, did the architect do any negligence or not? The bylaw said you have to provide earthquake resistant architecture. So the architect had knowledge about it. He asked the structural engineer to make sure there was earthquake resistant architecture, and yet the building fell. Even though everything was proper, you know, then it will be act of God and not professional negligence. Whereas if that architect didn't take enough care of prescribing earthquake resistant architecture while he was supposed to do it by the bylaws, and the building fell, even though it is act of God, yet it is a negligence of the architect. What does insurance cover? Now, this is very important slide, very important page to read regarding professional indemnity insurance. Very important things are, one is negligent act, another is error or omission in rendering or failure. What is error or omission? You were supposed to, first of all, error, you were supposed to write 10 mm or you were supposed to write 10 centimeter. By mistake, you wrote 10 inches. Professional error. Because you are, you know, confused between the metric and the imperial scales, or the person reading it, something happened. There was some confusion regarding metric and imperial scale imperial scales, foot to meter conversion. They were calculating in foot, you were writing in meters, or they asked in meters and you wrote in foot, something like that, you know, or you had your mindset ki you are doing in foot, but you are actually making the drawing in meter. This is a small, very commonly made mistake of units. So this is an error, professional error. What is omission? Omission is that you are supposed to make one line which was to show this is the rebar, or this is the restructure bar, or this is the reinforcement with that has to be put. That line was forgotten, or what happens is that line didn't get rendered. That line was too light and the person forgot to make it. Now that means is that when the building is being made, he didn't put that reinforcement and the building fell down. That is an omission. So in this, insurance covers, protects against negligent acts and errors and omission. This has to be proven. It is actually an omission. He made it. For example, he has to show with a physical drawing that he actually made it. While that drawing was being drafted, it got missed. So that is an omission. And what is the period of insurance? So period of insurance has a very important concept called retroactive date, which means that, see, for example, the building was made 3 years back, but the insurance is always 1 year. So it was bought this year, but the insurance cover would start from 3 years back. But the period of insurance is this year only. That means anything that happened in these 3 years, which is before you bought this year's insurance also, because insurance is this year, then next year, then before year. But the period is right from the time that the building was started, because you mentioned that in the policy. That is mentioned in the policy. So any negligence proven after that retroactive date is liable to be compensated for any damages if there is negligent act, error or omission. Four scenarios were helpful, where professional indemnity is helpful for architects, insurance is helpful for architects. Negligence or breach of duty, we have explained it. Infringement of intellectual property rights, we'll talk about it. Breach of confidence, you leaked some secret. And defamation, very common things nowadays. Other riders available, you know, so insurance has a concept of riders. What is riders? Ki, okay, this is a basic vanilla flavor insurance, like an ice cream, basic vanilla flavor. So basic vanilla flavor insurance is, it will give you protection. And no, I also want this extra cherry on top. So that's a rider. I also want extra choco chips on top. So that's a rider. Same way, in insurance, an additional option add-on that is given to the insurance. So what is infringement of intellectual property rights? You know, when copyright is violated. So will the architect be paid compensation under professional indemnity, even if he found guilty of violation? So I intentionally copied a building which somebody else has made. That's an infringement of copyright. Does it protect against that? We'll have to see whether the rider will have that option, because usually it is not covered when you're doing it willfully. If it happens by mistake, you know, it's a different story. But whether it was a willful and not out of negligence, but a willful intention of yours to do it, then, and the other person can prove it that it is willful, then it is not a error or omission or a negligent act. Then it is a violation of copyright. Yeah. So breach of confidence, sharing the product details with rivals, whether intentional or unintentional, the motive should be proven. Your employee whom you're about to sack leaks the documents, another case. Who will be held guilty and will the insurance company pay? These are very case-to-case matters, but this is something that is also in the purview. But when we see exclusions, you know, this is a normal insurance vanilla flavor. It excludes all these things, contractual liabilities. It will exclude faulty workmanship. It will exclude war, pollution, terrorism. It will exclude here it in the normal insurance, which the IRDAI, that is the Indian Regulatory Development Insurance Regulatory Development Authority of India, in the normal insurance which I took the sample of, their intellectual property rights are not covered. It's an exclusion. So you have to remember that it's an insurance policy and not your godfather. You still have to follow the law and make sure no mistakes are made unintentionally or intentionally. Take all due care and make sure there is no negligence. Insurance is just like a lifeboat. You make sure you don't sink the ship in the first place. Keywords in professional indemnity insurance: continuous insurance, which protects the firm perpetually, or project specific. So one is like you're taking for the firm, you're doing 10 projects, 20 projects, all the projects get covered by a single insurance policy, and it depends upon the number of events that happen. Okay, one event happened of negligence, two events, so you cover by the based on the events. Another approach is the project way. So one project, total project is covered, and that agreement is made between the client and the architect. And the legal fees for defense, you know, very important. The most expensive fees is the legal fees, which should be bought as a rider, you know, because it is the most expensive. So you tell your insurance company, please also cover the legal fees, even if it creates an increase in the premium. So this was professional indemnity insurance. So please remember with this one line that it's an insurance policy. It is not a godfather. Make sure you always, always, always have no negligent act. You double check, triple check, have people in the office whose work is just to check the drawings and check the processes, so that there is never a scope of any professional negligence. And mistakes happen even after that. For that, always have a professional indemnity insurance. Thank you very much.